Good afternoon, and thanks, Teresa. I want to take this for granted, being able to introduce a legend, at least in my eyes, someone I has looked up to for several years. As a social activist in 1967 at San Jose State, Dr. Harry Edwards orchestrated a black student protest for civil rights grievances that were ignored by upper administration. The results of this protest led to the canceling of the opening football game by San Jose State and the University of Texas, El Paso. He was one of the foot soldiers and architects of the Olympic Project for Human Rights, which produced one of the most iconic images of black athletic activism at the 1968 Olympics, labeled the Black Power Salute by John Carlos and Tommy Smith. As a scholar, Dr. Edwards received his PhD from Cornell University in sociology. He is a professor emeritus of sociology at the University of California, Berkeley, where he has served as a professor for over 30 years. Dr. Edwards has written extensively on the connections between race, sport, and society. He is the author of The Struggle That Must Be, an autobiography, one of the original texts on Sociology of Sport, The Revolt of the Black Athlete, which is currently in reprint by the University of Illinois Press. He is also the author of countless articles on race, sport, and the sociology of sport in both books, academic, and popular press. As a public scholar, he continues to speak to issues involving sport and current affairs. As a consultant, he has worked as a consultant. He has worked in the NFL and the NBA and has served as a special assistant to the Commissioner of Major League Baseball. He currently serves as a consultant for the San Francisco 49ers. Once a foot soldier, now general and commander for many scholars who seek to be advocates of change in the context of sport specifically and society in general. Dr. Harry Edwards still exhibits a fire in his belly for social justice, so please welcome Dr. Harry Edwards.
Thank you very much. As usual, the best introduction is always a brief one. Those who know don't need it. Those who don't care. So we can get right into the substance of my talk today. I want to speak about the fourth wave of black athletes in political protest, protest in the second decade of the 21st century. Who would have predicted that in the second decade of the 21st century, a mixed race, black, backup quarterback raised in the ultra-conservative town of Turlock, California, in the San Joaquin Valley, who went to school in the red state of Nevada and played quarterback at the University of Nevada, Reno, would launch an era of black athlete activism. In order to understand the current wave of black athlete activism, it must be put into the context and evolution of the contributions of black athletes in the past to the struggle for freedom, justice, and equality in America, particularly for black people. We begin at the turn of the century. Though this starting point of analysis is somewhat subjective, the turn of the 20th century clearly and unambiguously marked the end of the post-Civil War American experimentation with full citizenship rights, opportunities, and political equality for black people. Under national and states' rights measures reflective of separate but equal, laws were put into place, conventions and customs were established, and in one instance signed off on by the preeminent leader of the day, Booker T. Washington, who stated that we can be as separate as the fingers, but like one as the hand. This nation, in consequence, was plunged into a deeply rooted institutional, dark racial divide that would last long after its legal underpinnings had been expunged. It was in the climate and aftermath of this anti-black, race-based oppression that the development and evolution of black society and the black athlete in it were framed and forged. Throughout the history of black sports involvement in America, four factors have been critical in generating and framing and determining the trajectory of developments at the interface of race, sport, and society. The first is what I termed in 1971, with the publication of my dissertation, the first principle of the sociology of sport. Sport inevitably recapitulates the character, structure, and dynamics of human and institutional relationships within and between societies, and the ideological sentiments rationalizing and justifying those relationships. Sport is inescapably wound up with the structure, the human relationships, the dynamics, the character of those relationships in society. We invest in sport as a consequence. What we believe about our society, about ourselves as a people, what we believe about our institutions inevitably come to be reflected in sports, and we use that reflection as a reflection of who and what we are as a people and as a nation. But why should we care about what an athlete thinks? Why should we care about what somebody thinks who makes a living hitting a ball with a stick? Why should we care about what an athlete thinks who makes a living tackling somebody or throwing passes or putting a ball through a basket? The second factor I derive from the thoughts and observations of none other than Albert Einstein. In 1939, Einstein asserted, "Objective knowledge provides us with powerful instruments for achievement of certain ends. But the ultimate goal itself and the longing to reach that goal must come from another source, such goals cannot be derived by mere reason." Einstein goes on to stipulate that this longing, these goals, these aspirations exist as powerful traditions which act upon the conduct and aspirations and judgments of the individual. They are there, these goals, these aspirations are there as something living. They come into being not through reason or revelation, but through the medium of powerful personalities. We care about what athletes think because we have invested them with the basic ideologies, the basic character, the basic structure and dynamics of who we are as a nation and as a people. They become what Einstein called powerful personalities. And of course, there are no more powerful personalities and models in society than athletes, and particularly with regard to black society, than black athletes. The third factor framing and determining the trajectory of developments at the interface of sport, race, and society in America is, of course, the enduring yet ever-evolving problem of racism and its roots in white supremacy in this nation. This is as current and lived as the experiences and adulation that we hold for the athlete. We experience black athletes as powerful personalities, Tom Brady, LeBron James, Steph Curry, and so forth. We experience racism at that same level of feeling and sentiment. It was Dr. W.E.B. Du Bois who stated in 1904 that the problem of the 20th century is the problem of the color line. The problem of the 20th century has remained largely unresolved and substantively diminished only piecemeal, issue by issue, rather than being exercised root, branch, and all. In fact, it has metastasized into the problem of the 21st century, that is, the problem of diversity in all of its complexity and competing interests. And it is this situation of diversity that is contributing today to the framing of developments and particularly to black athlete activism in sports. With super affluent black athletes standing up, kneeling, and so forth on behalf of oppressed black people and oppressed black communities. And finally, there's this fourth factor. Framing and setting the trajectory of developments at the interface of sport, race, and now diversity and society. The media and its influence in creating black images in sports, in defining black actions and achievements in sports, and in disseminating those images and definitions. First wave black athlete activism was epitomized by Jack Johnson, Joe Louis, Jesse Owens, and to some extent by Paul Robeson and the Negro Leagues, and to some degree by historically black institutions of higher learning. From the turn of the 20th century up to the onset of World War II, America was a society substantially afflicted by racial segregation by law and custom. Despite some desegregated locker rooms in the North, and particularly in the Northeast, some instances in the Midwest, the black athlete who excelled and prevailed largely received their greatest respect, their greatest opportunities and recognition in the international arena. Jack Johnson, of course, epitomized both the constraints of Jim Crow segregation and rebellion against it. Jack Johnson won the heavyweight championship belt from Tommy Burns, a Canadian, in the 14th round of a fight in Sydney, Australia in 1908, after years of taunting and challenging white American fighters who refused to give him a title fight. But as the white sports establishment in America had suspected all along, Johnson wanted not only the title, he wanted it all. He wanted a full, unfettered life, unburdened by the constraints of segregation. And so he acted and carried himself as if, in point of fact, that system of racism and oppression did not exist. A disposition for which he was reviled by whites and reprimanded by blacks, who felt that he was imperiling the progress of the race by going rogue, by going too far afoul of Jim Crow conventions and expectations. Jack Johnson once walked into a segregated hotel in St. Louis and asked for a room. And when the desk clerk told him, "We don't rent rooms to your kind," his response was, "The room is not for me. It's for my lady, and she's not my kind, she's your kind." At which time, of course, they escorted him not only out of the hotel, but out of St. Louis. In fact, after Jack Johnson, it would be another 27 years before another black boxer would get an opportunity to fight for the heavyweight title. And again, it was in the international arena that that opportunity came. This time, with the backdrop of the struggle against American Jim Crow, compounded by the looming global conflagration with Nazi militarism and Aryan superiority ideology, along with Japanese imperialism, a reflection of human and institutional relationships between the West and some of these other societies and ideologies. In their first fight on June 19, 1936, Max Schmeling beat Joe Louis in 12 rounds. In their second fight on June 22, 1938, Joe Louis knocked Schmeling out in the first round. These were, of course, noteworthy fights as boxing spectacles, but against the backdrop of the broader political conflict and the looming specter of war, they became emblematic of the hopes and fears of an ever more fractured and volatile American and world order. After Joe Louis's June 1936 loss to Schmeling, There was increased pressure upon American Olympic athletes, and particularly the 18 black athletes on the team, on the United States Olympic team in 1936, to perform well at the 1936 Munich Olympic Games. Into that breach stepped Jesse Owens. His four gold medal performance and the myth that Hitler refused to shake his hand is now the stuff of legend. What is less popularly known is that Jesse Owens was the first black athlete of the 20th century to propose a boycott of the Olympic Games. In his case, because of the treatment of minorities in Germany, both his advocacy and his arguments were withdrawn in the wake of criticism from some segments of the black press and community, and in the face of a fact-finding trip to Germany by U.S. Olympic Committee President Avery Brundage, a demonstrable racist and anti-Semite who reported back that the alleged persecution of Jews and other minorities in Germany was largely a media-driven fiction and that Hitler was an honorable man. Also, the black press had specifically noted the contradiction in the proposed boycott of the German Olympics by black athletes over the treatment of minorities in Germany, while black people in America suffered under institutionalized segregation and discrimination, racism, and even lynching. Paul Robeson was a great first wave black athlete who utilized his athletic prowess to forge paths for expression of his incomparable artistic and oratorical abilities. But like Johnson, Owens, and Lewis, and several other black athletes of the era, such as cyclist Major Taylor, it was in the international arena again that Robeson gained his greatest first wave recognition as an artist and as an orator. For all of his brilliance, for example, as a singer at his alma mater, Rutgers, he was never even so much as invited to join the glee club. And ultimately, it was his standing and identity on the world stage and what he said while on that stage that brought him to the greatest attention domestically, most of it negative. In point of fact, the United States government effectively declared him a non-person, and it also led to black society abandoning him all but completely. Jackie Robinson, a second wave athlete of some standing and eminence, of course, was prompted by Congress to attack Robeson for his words and public pronouncements concerning the Soviet Union and going to war with the Soviet Union over ideology and expansion. Over time, Johnson, Lewis, Owens, and Robeson all shared a common fate of being in one way or another, publicly and humiliatingly disabused and defrocked of their internationally based stature and standing at home, cut down to size by U.S. Institutional powers, and in some instances, all but completely impoverished. Jack Johnson was convicted under a bogus law and prosecuted for having crossed state lines, supposedly, allegedly, with a woman for illicit purposes. Joe Lewis was hounded and harassed for years over income tax issues, and finally, in his last years, reduced to shaking hands at a Las Vegas casino in order to make a living. Jesse Owens, initially stripped of his amateur athletic status and barred from track and field for life, when he refused to be exploited financially any longer by USOC and IOC officials and events. He returned home to a job as a park janitor and ultimately ended up racing horses in circuses and in stunts in order to make a living. And he also got the Al Capone treatment, that is being harassed and in a couple of instances convicted around income tax issues. Nonetheless, this first wave of black athletes and their international status came to establish unequivocally the legitimacy of black athletic competitiveness on the athletic field, a legitimacy buttressed and affirmed by such organizations as the Negro Leagues, basketball teams such as the Renaissance Team of New York City, the Washington D.C. Bears, neither of which clowned or did reams like the Globetrotters, both of which were outstanding, legitimate basketball teams, and so good that after a period of time, they could find no one willing to play them. In point of fact, the Washington DC Bears won 63 straight games, some of which were against professional white teams. They soon found themselves, however, as I stated, unable to find competitors, and leading up to World War II, they had all but completely collapsed. In the wake of the second wave of athlete contributions to the struggle, this time for desegregation and access to the American mainstream, the Negro Leagues, along with most other vestiges of an era of abject segregation, would begin to erode and ultimately to collapse. So all of those athletes who came prior to World War II really established the legitimacy of black athletic competitiveness and so forth under circumstances where a great part of segregation was to promote the notion that blacks were physically, intellectually, morally incapable of competing against whites in athletics. They established the legitimacy of black athletic talent by competing against the world, by showing themselves as competent on the world stage. This would all come to an end with World War II and the onset of the second wave of black athletes. The second wave, again, involved developments at the interface of race, sport, and society, framed and fueled by both national and international issues and concerns, much as segregation and international competition had framed the activities and outcomes of the first wave. It was post-World War II years. America had emerged victorious from what was essentially a war over race, over whether the modern world would be shaped by the ideologies of Nazi-Aryan superiority and Japanese imperialism, or by ideologies of institutional structures and processes grounded in democratic principles and assumptions of individual freedom. It was also the case that black Americans had envisioned World War II as a two-pronged racial struggle, a double V struggle, as it was called, victory over racism overseas and victory over racism at home. So with the end of World War II, there ensued a struggle abroad against the continued colonization of non-white peoples by Western allied and defeated Axis powers, and in America, an intensified agitation, more demonstrations against racial segregation. And sport was a vanguard institutional site for that struggle. And athletes were frontline troops in that fight. In the battle for hearts and minds in resource-rich, non-white, so-called third world countries, increasingly decolonized countries, the U.S. was at a tremendous disadvantage, principally because of its treatment of American citizens of color right here at home, a situation that was actively exploited by the rising anti-capitalist, communist, and socialist nations of the world led by China and the Soviet Union. So changes had to be made. a presidential decree eliminating segregation in the military, the increasing passage of anti-segregation laws at the federal level, the desegregation of select sports locker rooms. And finally, by the onset of the 1950s, there was a burgeoning post-war civil rights movement emerging, which gave both voice and impetus to the push for broader black democratic participation. Again, things in the world and in society framed the actions and activities of black athletes. It was in this climate of challenges to the established politics and culture of race in America that the black athlete again became the most visible face of change in the guise of Kenny Washington and Woody Strode, Marion Motley and Bill Willis in football, of Jackie Robinson and Larry Doby in baseball, of Earl Lloyd and Chuck Cooper in basketball, all powerful personalities influencing black aspirations and goals. In the wake of this struggle for access, not only would strides be made to dismantle the most obvious and visibly evident manifestations of forced segregation, but the productive integrity and viability of the black institutional structures that had produced and permitted demonstrable black athletic legitimacy were increasingly either seriously weakened and eroded or outright destroyed in the course of this push for access. So by 1956, 10 years after Jackie Robinson joined the Brooklyn Dodgers in 1946, the Negro Leagues and the various segregation-era professional basketball teams had all but completely collapsed, and the Negro, now historically black colleges and universities were already well on their way to not being able to recruit blue chip black athletes in competition with predominantly white colleges and universities. A development which both the black and white interest in the media pushed for acceptance of, for accommodation of, as being just part of the price of increased access. Nothing could be said about either the impact upon black institutions and their structures and opportunities, or the fact that even in these desegregated locker rooms, all was not well. Positional segregation in these locker rooms, hiring discrimination, the glacially slow pace of expanding desegregation to front offices, expanding and enforcing, and all of this led to an expanded and more intensified effort by younger athletes in particular to take stands that seemed to fly in the face of everything that had been achieved by the earlier generations of second wave athletes. The civil rights movement itself had begun to change, and there was a rise of the black power movement within the context of the civil rights movement. All of this framed and fueled a passion for a change of direction and methods by a rising third wave of black athletes who would take seriously the disposition of Jackie Robinson, who had by 1960 began to cease to stand up for the national anthem or to say the Pledge of Allegiance. Those of us who were involved in the late 1960s were aware that that was Jackie's stand, and we stepped up to integrate that disposition into our perspectives in terms of this third wave of athlete activism. We were already clear that it was time for a new black athlete to emerge. There were the likes of Jim Brown, Bill Russell, and most certainly Cassius Clay. Later, of course, under the political guidance and imagery of Those three individuals, particularly with the metamorphosis of Cassius Clay into Muhammad Ali, a whole generation of athletes began to look beyond the accomplishments and achievements and the perspectives and methods of second generation, second wave athletes to a new tack in terms of expressing themselves and their political involvement with the black community. The athletes who followed the paths established by Jim Brown and Bill Russell and Ali, the Arthur Ashe, Tommy Smith, John Carlos, Kurt Flood, and black athletes from San Jose State, Syracuse University, the University of Wyoming, Oregon, Cal, Washington, St. Mary's College, and other predominantly white institutions did what was then the unthinkable. They rebelled against the white sports establishment and its member institutions, colleges and universities. The Olympic Committee itself became a target of these rebellions, along with most of the professional football leagues, which involved substantial numbers of black athletes. And first, as the mainstream media failed to consistently chronicle and document the day-to-day realities of second-wave athletes in the desegregated locker room of an otherwise still very much segregated and racist American sports institution. No major newspaper had a reporter follow Jackie Robinson as he went from team to team playing on the road. He was only covered when he was in New York by the New York Times, for example. No major newspaper recounted what athletes were actually going through in the desegregated situation to the extent that it was reflective of the realities of that situation. That same media had no idea of what to do with these third wave athletes, of how to frame and define this new black athlete who not only talked about race, a tremendous no-no for second wave athletes, and advocated against racism, again, within and beyond the arena, but who in many instances publicly talked about civil rights and aligned themselves with the civil rights movement. Bill Russell and his efforts to support the NAACP and voters' rights campaigns during the Freedom Summer Movement of 1965. Muhammad Ali and his involvement with Malcolm X and the Nation of Islam. Jim Brown and his flirtations with the Nation of Islam and the National Urban League, the NAACP, the Congress of Racial Equality, and a number of other civil rights organizations, all of which would have been unthinkable in any kind of public way for second wave black athlete activists. As black athletes became more openly activist and outspoken relative to issues of race and racism, the mainstream media and the sports establishment became more critical and caustic in condemning them. Ali was a draft dodger and a traitor to all of those who acceded to the military draft and donned the uniform. Bill Russell was dubbed in the Boston newspapers as Felton X because of his stand against racism, not just in America, but specifically in Boston and in the NBA. One of the most caustic attacks on Russell came when he made the statement that when it came to opportunities for blacks in basketball, pattern was to play two at home, three on the road, and five when you got behind. They thought that that was absolutely unconscionable for someone of his stature and so forth to make that statement about a sport that had been so good to him. Jim Brown was condemned as surly, angry, frighteningly militant, and outspoken. Smith and Carlos were deemed nothing but stormtroopers for their actions around the Olympic Games. Kurt Flood was seen as ungrateful and at one point as deranged. The collegiate athletes who rebelled against their campus and athletic circumstances were likewise deemed ungrateful and misguided. So let's quickly summarize here. The pattern that has emerged from wave after wave after wave of athletes who have rebelled, who become activists, is clear. First wave black athletes from 1900 to 1945 struggled for legitimacy, just to be recognized for the great athletes that they were. This happened mostly in the international arena. Segregated and ignored by the mainstream press in America, cut down to a tolerable dimensions at home when they achieved international stardom, recognition, acclaim, and respect, derided and defamed in the mainstream press after their fall as either pathetic dumb jocks who couldn't control their money or undependable dupes and public and political puppets as they tried to frame Paul Robeson. Second wave black athletes, 1946 to 1960s, permitted limited political access with a gradual increase in the number, permitted limited positional access with a gradual increase in their numbers and positional diversity over time, admonished to remain quiet on issues of race and racism, unless it was how much progress was being made by the fact that they were in desegregated locker rooms. They were supposed to remain quiet about race and racism, both within and beyond the arena, cast in the mainstream media as either happy-go-lucky, Ernie Banks, let's play two, or by national media, or as by natural temperament or cognitive deficiency inclined to turn the other cheek, or simply willing to go along with racism to get along. This, as the old story went, as part of the price of admission to the mainstream. Many black newspapers, as well as white newspapers, ignored the realities of second wave black athletes because they thought that, promoted this notion that this was just part of the price of admission to the mainstream. Be quiet, go and play, shut up, sit down. While also, not coincidentally, allowing even their white teammates and coaches, those closest to them, the excuse that they had no idea what the second wave black athletes were living with and experiencing while they were desegregating these teams. Third wave black athletes struggled for dignity and respect, and so were openly critical of racism both within and beyond the arena. Predictably, the response of the media was vociferous. They were castigated, not in challenge of the factual basis of their outspokenness and concerns, but in criticism of their protest, the protests themselves, the methods that they use, one or more venues that they may have. Don't protest during the game. Don't protest after the game. Don't protest in your uniform. I mean, these were the challenges that third wave black athletes faced from the media. Black athlete activists from the third wave in particular felt the lash of the mainstream media under one pretext or another, because what the mainstream media and the mainstream audience really wanted these black athletes to do was to play their sports, then to sit down and shut up the way that second wave athletes did. From the end of the third wave era, which declined and had all but completely dissipated by the mid-1970s. Along with the decline of the civil rights movement, the black power movements, and so forth, to the onset of the 21st century, some 25 years later, there were no broad-scale societal forces framing and fueling black attitudes and dispositions. Not only was it possible for high-profile black athletes during this period to declare such sentiments as "Republicans buy gym shoes too," and "I'm not a role model," but to have no broad-scale castigation come their way in the wake of these statements. People would say, well, that was an interesting thing that Michael said, or geez, what did Charles Barkley really mean by that? But there was no broad-scale castigation consistent with the weight and implications of what they were saying. By the late 1990s, things had gone so far as to permit advocates from both left and right to argue that so much progress had been made in the struggle against racism that we had actively entered an era of post-racial America, a delusion seemingly validated some 8 years later in 2008 with the election of the first African-American president of the United States. But for all of the rhetoric and imagery about having arrived at a post-racial America, there was one factor that could not be fooled, that could not be either dissuaded or distracted from the factual realities, and that was the modern mass media. Initially, at the end of the 20th century, into the first decade of the 21st century, it was popular access to the internet, emails, and the capacity for instant communication to vast numbers of people simultaneously that fueled the popularity of the new social media. By the onset of the second decade of the 21st century, the capacity to send both words and pictures had become commonplace and extensively used, the effect being that the mainstream media could no longer determine and frame the message. They could no longer shield the public from divergent points of view, nor overwhelm such messaging by sheer power of the and distribution of interlocking media outlets and interest. They could no longer gang up, come together, have one editorial perspective and push that on the public. The social media ended all of that. From the use of the social media to the development of the ability to putting in the hands the ability to access that media, the use of the social media became the central means of communication, not just in society more generally, but among athletes as well. Black athlete sentiments in the wake of this situation began to have an almost immediate impact. This was power that was unknown in previous generations. From the use of the social media by the Miami Heat to put out their hoodie protest in 2012, to the use of that same media to communicate black player sentiments in the wake of Don Sterling's comments, where they literally got rid of an owner, to the St. Louis Rams players taking the field and the hands up, don't shoot gesture, and that image going viral, to the Missouri football players announcing online that they supported the protest of students, which ended in the elimination of the president, the chancellor, and the head football coach, to the University of Oklahoma player whose rant against a racist chant by a fraternity went viral. Athletes began to understand that thanks to this media, they literally had power. Colin Kaepernick taking a knee during the playing of the national anthem was in 2016 was just the latest instance of this use of power. There has been a steady groundswell of black athlete activism built around the social media. Such a groundswell that it now constitutes a fourth wave of athlete activism, distinct and different from what happened in the late 1960s, and most certainly a break with what happened in the interim between the mid-1970s and about 2005, when there was no broad-scale movement to help frame the situation. Framing this fourth wave has been a broad-scale society-based ideological disposition, namely the Black Lives Matter movement. Like the Black Power movement, the Black Lives Matter movement is sufficiently provocative in its message to project a trajectory and a course of action across a broad variety of institutional fronts, but sufficiently nondescript in its mandates to accommodate almost any protest method and emphasis, pretty much as the Black Power movement in the late 1960s. You could have subscribed to Black Power and demand more black professors on campus, black studies, more emphasis on black history in the history department, and also a separate black house and black cultural center in the midst of all of the demands for full involvement in the university. So a team wearing hoodies, taking the field, displaying the hands up, don't shoot gesture, or wearing an I can't breathe warm-up jersey, or in it starts with us warm-up jersey if you're in the WNBA, or a team locking arms, or a single athlete taking a knee, can all be interpreted as gestures in support of the Black Lives demand for justice for people of color in this country. The camera phone has provided both substantive, both substance and poignancy to these athlete protests and to the incident that gave validity to incidents that give validity to athletes and Black Lives Matter proclamations and concerns. This fourth wave of black athletes ultimately are in pursuit of power. Just as the first wave, their ultimate impact was to demonstrate the legitimacy of their athleticism. Just as the second wave struggled for access. Just as the third wave, with Bill Russell and Jim Brown, Arthur Ashe, Muhammad Ali, struggle for dignity and respect. This fourth wave is in pursuit of power. They often are walking corporations making upwards of $20 million a year each. They understand financial power and are quickly learning an ability to leverage that power into the power to forge change, political change that would have been unimaginable to the first, second, and third wave black athletes. Black athletes today in the NBA compelled the removal of an owner. Black football players at the University of Missouri forced the resignation of the president, the chancellor, and the head football coach. LeBron James, Dwayne Wade, Carmelo Anthony, and Chris Paul asked for and got time on the ESPYs award stage to make a protest statement. Colin Kaepernick derided and disparaged in the mainstream media, up to and including the mainstream media seeking out footage of fans burning his jersey, went to the social media, and today his jersey is the number one selling jersey in the NFL, and if it continues on its current trajectory by the end of this season, on a team that has won one game in the first half of the season, his jersey will be the highest selling jersey in NFL history. And if you think that's amazing, pictures of Colin Kaepernick signed autographed copies of the Time magazine cover, which had him on the cover, autographed, are now selling for upwards of $5,000 on the internet, on the social media. What the New York Times sports page thinks of Colin Kaepernick is irrelevant. It doesn't matter. It's a new power relationship going on here. That is power. Now the challenge is to translate it into next steps in bridging the gap between protest and progress, between social media challenge and substantive change. On another point, one final point, there are no final victories. The struggle for legitimacy continues. That's what the machinations around the black lady that won a gold medal in swimming was about the young lady who was the greatest gymnast that anyone had ever seen was about. Well, we didn't know you all could do that. What is that about? The struggle for legitimacy continues. The fight for desegregation of front offices in both sport and society continues. The struggle for access continues. The struggle for dignity and respect continues, both in society and in sports, which is why there's such why it resonates so much. We're all experiencing the same thing, whether it's the first African American president under attack, down to and including the notion that he's not even an American, to how the gymnast hair looked, what's happening with the swimmer when she's standing on the podium during the playing of the national anthem. All of this is indicative of the fact that there are no final victories. The struggle for power is just underway in sports and continues in society, especially what Black Power called black control of the black community. It's politics, it's economy, it's law enforcement, it's institution, and even its culture and heritage. Believe it or not, the USOC has sent me a letter after 50 years saying, Dr. Edwards, you have no right to call anything the Olympic Project for Human Rights, because we have proprietary ownership of the word Olympic. Now, the Olympic Project for Human Rights belongs to African American people. They have a whole section of the new museum, National Museum of African American History and Culture in DC, dedicated to the Olympic Project for Human Rights. They got a statue at the entryway to the sports hall of Smith and Carlos and the demonstration at Mexico City. Over 200 books have been written about the Olympic Project for Human Rights. They say you can't use that button, you can't use that logo after 50 years. The struggle continues, and there are no final victories. The main point of everything that I've told you here is that what we see today is neither unique nor merely a mimicking of the 1960s. Waves of black athlete activism are both inevitable and rationally comprehensible. The only thing that is not comprehensible, that we cannot predict, is why would it be a Colin Kaepernick? We cannot predict who, we cannot predict where, we cannot predict when, but we know that it's coming. Why? Because sport is inextricably intertwined with society and recapitulates those struggles. And athletes, being powerful personalities, come to be fixated upon in terms of arbiters, examples of that struggle. So while we may not have been able to predict a Colin Kaepernick, a Colin Kaepernick was just as inevitable as a Jesse Owens, a Joe Louis, a Jack Johnson, a Jackie Robinson, a Kenny Washington, a John Carlos, a Tommy Smith, a Muhammad Ali. Absolutely inevitable. Why? Because that is the dynamic that we're dealing with. And this one is far from over. Thank you. I'll take some questions. Thank you.
We have some time for questions, and if you'll just raise your hand, I'll come with the mic since there's so many people.
Hi, thank you, Eric. What you've been talking about, from my perspective, seems like men's protests, largely men's protests in the civil rights and African-American rights, and I'm wondering if you could speak a bit more about where female athletes have been positioned in this process, and if there are any unique challenges that female athletes in particular face.
You should go online. There's somebody turn the lights out in here? Come on, brother. Don't do that to me. They're telling us it's time to go. Okay. If you go online, I did a talk in Texas a couple of years ago entitled Paradigm Shift. And none of this, I don't care how we figure it, is going to work unless women are factored in. I'm to the point now, anytime I go any place and somebody's presenting a program or anything like that, I always ask, where are women and girls in this? And if they tell me, I'm gone. Because I know it's not going anywhere. Especially when you're talking about African-American circumstances. Women are the key to resolving a lot of the challenges that we're talking about in the African-American community. Whether we're looking at health issues and obesity, well, guess who buys the food? Guess who fixes the food? Guess who decides what food to bring home and so forth? We're talking about medical care. Well, guess who's the first one generally to find out somebody's sick? And guess who takes them to the clinic? And guess who's there with them when they're rehabbing at home? Young brother? No, I don't think so. I did for 10 years. I was a counselor in San Quentin and San Bruno County Jail in San Francisco. And every single person that left that jail, they didn't go home to their homies. They didn't go home to, you know, the brothers on the block. They went home to mama's house, to grandmama's house, to aunt's house, to a sister's house, to a lady's house if they were really lucky. If you want to deal with education, guess who buys the school supplies? Guess who the overwhelming majority of the school teachers are? Guess who's there for the homework? Guess who goes to the PTA meetings? Guess who? In point of fact, in the African-American community, the only one that's holding this thing together are women. Brothers incarcerated, ganged up, far too often in situations where he's not able to function, get a steady job, and so forth in any regular way. Women are holding this thing together. And so when you look at that from that broad scale, nothing that we're going to be able to do, nothing that Colin Kaepernick is fighting for, is going to happen unless we somehow structure it not around women, but with women at the center. In terms of women athletes themselves, women athletes, black, white, and otherwise, today face the greatest threat in terms of their participation and so forth in sport that they've faced since they became, since Title IX. Principally because of assaults on women's medical services. People remember Title IX in 1972, but what they forget is that Roe v. Wade also came in 1972. And this gave colleges and universities, I was on a campus at that time, I was teaching at that time, this gave colleges and universities some assurance that they could bring this young lady in and she's not going to have to leave in the middle of the basketball season because she's pregnant. And clinics on campus, for the most part, immediately began to adopt women's health services as a major service, especially when it came to the athletic department. And now all of a sudden you see these states where there's a broad scale assault on women's clinics. Texas had 44. They're now down to 14 with only four able to have admission arrangements with hospitals, which is a basic factor in terms of determining if they can legitimately provide women's medical services. So in some instances in Texas, a woman would have to drive 500 miles. Well, I don't know a lot of young college co-eds on a basketball team are running track and everything, and all of a sudden just jump in a car and drive 500 miles and pay some price that, especially if it's out of state because the insurance and everything wouldn't cover. These are all challenges that confront women athletes. And when you look at the impact that this has in terms of women's access to sports, when you look at the impact that the ignoring of women's status, circumstances, outcomes in African American community in particular has relative to the development of the African American community and dealing with a lot of the problems that we have that only reverberate with black athletes when they get to the campus. We're in trouble unless we put women at the center of everything that we're talking about. Historically, women have been ignored because really up until Title VII, up until 1972, they couldn't, they weren't brought into sports. They could be ignored, the exception of the women from the historically black schools. Wilma Rudolph, and some people forget that Wilma Rudolph had a child when she was running in the Olympics. We forget about that kind of stuff because it's convenient to forget about it. And I don't think we could go back there again and be effective. So women have to be involved in every single aspect of everything that I've talked about. And Colin and I talk every day, Colin Kaepernick and I talk every day, and one of the things that we talk about is the role, circumstances, outcome, status of women and girls, and how what he is doing can move that process ahead. But I would go online and look up University of Texas, maybe a couple of years ago, I don't know when it was, but the title of the lecture that I gave was Paradigm Shift. And what we need is a paradigm shift where women are not brought into the conversation, but put at the center of the conversation, because otherwise the rest of this is not going to work.
PDF is still available. I just downloaded it.
Excellent. So the PDF is still available.
Yes, it is.
You can download it. Excellent.
Dr. Edwards, thank you for being here. You mentioned a lot about the economics being part of the equation now and having that sort of authority, social media, the national and international platforms that the professional and international athletes have now. How can younger athletes, even high school age athletes, get involved in this process? Because we've seen the isolated case at Missouri, but how can younger athletes that maybe don't have that platform and that economic power and stature that you speak about get involved in this equation?
Well, of course, the point that you're making, that once you become a professional athlete, I don't care if you're only making a couple of million a year. You're you have a degree of leverage and economic power. And of course, what the University of Missouri proved that collectively, as a team, those athletes have power. The high school athletes, the younger athletes, the greatest thing that they could do is their homework. They're at a stage where they need to try to learn as much as they possibly can. One of the things that I admonish athletes, whether I'm speaking to the Seattle Seahawks or whether I'm speaking to the Golden State Warriors or to the Detroit Lions, where I'll be next week, or the San Francisco 49ers, is that before you say anything, do your homework. Young athletes have to first of all learn to dream with their eyes open. Sports is not a panacea. It is something that you do that has a price to it. It has tremendous benefits, but there are also liabilities. So they have to first, if they're going to be young athletes, learn to dream with their eyes open. The second thing is do your homework around all of those areas that you see potentially impacting the arena in which you have chosen to perform, to operate. And if you don't do that homework, as I told a group of athletes last week, the best thing to do is just sit down and shut up. Otherwise, you end up sounding like some people sitting on a desk, you know, calling the people of Ferguson thugs, or those folks in Baltimore, they need to be locked up. And, you know, because they haven't done their homework, and because they have some status and standing as a former athlete, they think that that makes them, because they're powerful personalities, that make what they say factual and valid, and of course it does not. So for younger athletes, what I always tell them is, first of all, learn to dream with your eyes open in terms of your athletic involvement, and secondly, do your homework before you speak up. Understand what it is you're talking about. Understand of the consequences of your words, and be prepared to defend both. That's the greatest thing that they could do, is to educate themselves.
I have a question about the role of media and kind of the shifts between the first and the second wave and now where we are. And so it seems as though when you were in your talk, you stated that the major news outlets didn't really follow the stories of a lot of the black activists because there was a little bit of exclusion and silencing and a selective choice. So now with the shift to social media, you know, some of that catalyst for those stories are coming from people just copying public tweets,
absolutely,
right? So there seems to be some type of responsibility that these activists or these, I guess, selected and voluntold activists within the athletic community have to have. So what would you say to those athletes that might be thrown into the spotlight, not by choice, but merely just because they're public and now they have 10,000 tweets or they're on Instagram? What would you say to them or say to those of us who might be working with them or mentoring them in the future and currently so that we can help them be responsible, but also not silenced simultaneously?
What I tell athletes, almost every day, is that words matter. You cannot, in this age, where you are dealing with the most explosive, provocative, dangerous, four-letter word in human history, S-E-N-D, just become outright reckless in terms of what you're doing. You have to understand that when you hit send, it goes, you may only think I'm sending this to 15 people, but each one of them knows 15. Each one of them knows 15. Next thing you know, it's in a network, and because you are a powerful personality, owing to the simple fact that you wear that uniform once a week, or twice a week, or three times a week, or that you're on television hitting a ball with a stick, or putting a ball through a hoop, it carries power. And so you have to understand your responsibility in managing what you put out, what you say, how you frame stuff up. And if you do not, then you should, at a minimum, be prepared for the consequences. Words matter. Pictures matter. How you frame things up matter. Even under circumstances where the framing of your arguments are broader, such as Black Lives Matter, than your immediate wording, that does not absolve you from the responsibility for that wording. So you can be right on in terms of speaking out against injustice to people of color and police killings of people of color. But if you cross the line and begin to call for the killing of police, you have to live with that. That's one that you have to live with. And there have been, I've known people who come very close to that line that I've had to walk back and say, hey, you know, that conversation that we have with our sons and daughters before they leave the house every day, the sons and daughters of police have that same conversation with them every day. They put on that badge, strap on that gun, and walk out that house in that blue uniform. Mom, Dad, we want you to come home. Keep your head on the swivel. We want you to be safe. We want to see you back here at the dinner table tonight. You can't get sloppy with these critical issues. You can't even leave yourself open to be interpreted as being sloppy with these critical issues. As emotional and as passionate as you might feel about the fact that Black people in America today are killed at a higher rate by police officers than the average number of lynchings per year from 1882 to 1968, which was 40. There are over 140 Black people killed by police officers every year in this country, three times as many. So, but you can't get sloppy with that. And so you have to get them to understand the power of this media. Nobody can manage it. CIA can't manage it. United States government can't manage it. Nobody can manage the internet. Nobody can manage the social media. And once it's out there forever. It's out there forever. What you said is out there forever. And so to try to give them some notion of the power that's at the tip of their fingers, and that sometimes when you're sitting up at 2 o'clock in the morning and had a couple of brews, thinking about something that you read in the paper or saw on TV or somebody said, don't just sit up and say, well, boom, sin, because you have to live with that. We all do. So you always want to ever be pressing the power that's at the hands, at the fingertips of the average individual today. And if you're one of those powerful personalities, an athlete, that power is magnified by virtue of the fact of who's using it. And I try to continually press that, but it's a hard one to wrap your mind around. It's really a hard one for a young person to wrap their mind around. They grew up with it. They take it commonplace. You know, like when I grew up with the rotary telephone, I didn't think nothing about picking up the phone and calling my grandmama in California, but my dad thought that, man, this is, wow, this is way out. Okay?
Dr. Edwards, Drew Brown from University of Houston. I certainly enjoyed your talk. I had a question on, you spoke about the evolution of the athlete to the fourth wave, and we talked about the different roles and responsibilities they now take on. You even just now talked about sort of the change in the way we approach media. For scholars and academicians and intellectual leaders, has their role or responsibility also changed or evolved with the evolution of the athlete?
Absolutely. When I began to write about sport and society in the early and mid-1960s, the standard perspective on sport and society was as this
citadel of interracial harmony and brotherhood because it was in the forefront. The media essentially pressed everything down, both the black and the white media. Nobody discussed exactly what was going on in desegregated locker rooms. And even though every now and then the black media would say something about Jackie Robinson and what he was putting up with on the field, nobody really bore down into the dynamics of what was happening and why it was happening. And the fact that what Jackie was involved in had nothing to do with brotherhood, it had to do with business. Branch Rickey was smart enough to know that there was an untapped pool of black athletic talent coming out of World War II when Major League Baseball had a manpower shortage, and on top of that, there was an untapped pool of black dollars that they, Major League Baseball, could have access to at a time when discretionary dollars were scarce. What happened with Branch Rickey and Jackie Robinson had nothing to do with brotherhood. That was a nice cover. It had to do with business. Branch Rickey was a hell of a businessman. And so the writers didn't bore down into that. So when I started writing, I took a more critical point of view. And point of fact, I took an activist point of view. Not just the objective, even detached scholar, but someone who was passionately attached, committed to the things that I was involved with intellectually and academically. There was a change that went on. The thing that you are confronted with today is something that I didn't have to deal with. I mean, even in my most activist days, my days with the Black Panther Party, and hanging out with Malcolm X and organizing athletes. I mean, I would get on a rotary telephone and call 100 people, hope that 20 of them would call me back, and hope that I would be sitting there when 10 times when the phone rang. Today, the social media has changed all of that, and history is not what happened with first wave athletes. It's not what happened with second wave athletes. It's what happened this morning, because now we're in the afternoon and something else has transpired that has changed the whole trajectory and so forth of something that you may have been working on for 4 or 5 or 6 or 7 months. All of a sudden you got to go back and redo that whole thing, because why? The whole framing of this thing has taken place. I don't know what a guy, let me tell you, sir, a guy that I know was working on why you don't have this activism among athletes that you had in the 1960s. And he had talked about the money that they're making, they're not interested, they no longer live in African-American community and therefore don't care and so forth and so on. They're now really a part of mainstream America. And then all of a sudden, Colin Kaepernick takes a knee, and he's got to go back, redo his whole paper, tear up all of his charts, everything's up. And as he went back and looked at it, and looked at what had happened leading up to it, from Los Suns warm-ups that the Phoenix Suns wore, right up through Ariana Smith of Knox College, Galesburg, Illinois, the first athlete to protest the police killings, when she walked out on the floor in Staton, Missouri, and laid down in front of the flag during the playing of the national anthem for 4 minutes and 30 seconds in commemoration of the 4 hours and 4.5 hours that Mike Brown's body lay in the streets of Ferguson, 10 miles away from Staton. He had to go back and redo all of that. And once he did, within the context of the social media and the response to Kaepernick, his response to me was, of course, how could it have ever been anything else? I miss the whole thing. But once it was framed, once Kaepernick happened, and he could see more clearly the path and trajectory that this whole thing was taking, it became clear. So the first thing that your generation of scholars has to understand, you don't have the time that I had to mull over something. I look back at Jackie Robinson, that was history. This was 1946. I was operating in 1967, 68. You don't have that kind of time. You got to look at what happened yesterday. Did anything go down while I was asleep? You know, and if it did, all of a sudden you could have 10 million people writing about it. You've got to somehow manage to integrate that into your into your thought processes and your analysis. That means a heck of a lot more, not prediction, but analytical projection. You've got to look at all possibilities and then look at the evidence and say, okay, where is this thing headed? Where are we going to come out at? That's the major difference. If you're going to be activist, scholar activist in particular, where you're going to be looking at this stuff from a particular advocacy point of view, you better know what you're talking about. And that's more and more difficult because it changes so fast.
How's it going, Dr. Edwards? Good to see you again.
Yeah, I'm still on this side of the lawn, and I'm doing better than I deserve.
All right. So I'm just curious if you could talk a little bit more about that 25 to 30-year gap between the third wave and fourth wave. Like, what was going on in society that, I guess, delayed now this fourth wave that we see going on?
Mm-hmm. The biggest issue that happened, and I date it from the assassination of Dr. King, is that the civil rights movement, and most certainly the Black Power movement, that had so fueled that third wave, collapsed for all practical purposes. It collapsed. And because there was no action, and because the civil rights movement had achieved some successes, voting rights, civil rights, women's rights in the workplace to a certain extent, Roe v. Wade, opening up athletics and opportunities and so forth for women, there was the presumption that we had moved into a different era. And there were those both left and right who declared that we were in post-racial America, that the whole notion of discrimination, division, and so forth based on race was no longer a reality, that all differences could be explained either through abilities, capability, economics, all those kind of things. But we were in a post-racial America. And then when Barack Obama ran, and to everybody's surprise, most Black folks didn't expect that and didn't believe it when it happened. They thought that the mainstream media was messing with them. Elected not just once, but twice. There were people saying, we're in post-racial America. But then for that period of time, when there was not this broad scale framing that the civil rights movement, the Black Power movement, segregation with the first wave, desegregation with the second wave, Black Power with the third wave, when that framing was not there, it was possible for athletes to stand up and say, hey, I'm not a role model. Don't look to me for nothing. It was possible for somebody to say, we have a Black senatorial candidate running against the arch racist Jesse Helm. Mr. Jordan, will you donate to his campaign and endorse him? And literally have a response, Republicans buy gym shoes too. And people say, well, he's a businessman. I understand. This time around, because of the framing and the fact that so many other athletes were stepping up, making themselves heard on the social media and in person at the ESPYs, Mr. Jordan not only forgot about Republicans buying gym shoes, he gave $2 million to organizations who were about minimizing this pattern of summary execution of Black people by police officers. So the framing was what was missing during that period of time. And once Black Lives Matter took off and began to frame up the situation against the backdrop of almost weekly camera phone pictures, video of Black people being shot, by police officers as the quintessential injustice. Everything was framed up again. Athletes began to stand up again. You cannot minimize the impact of the social media in this. In this idea, I was with a thing with Jim Brown, and we got into a discussion about you know how do you react when you're confronted with a police officer, and you know you say, well, you keep your hands on the wheel, you know you keep your hands on the wheel. Well, I guess there's some validity to that. Maybe Trayvon Martin's problem was he didn't have his hands on the wheel. Maybe Oscar Grant's problem was that he didn't have his hands on the wheel. Maybe Sandra Bryan didn't have her hands on the wheel. Maybe little Ariana Jones, 7 years old, was shot to death in her grandmama's living room. Her problem was she didn't have her hands on the wheel. Maybe Eric Garner's problem really was that the bottom line, he didn't have his hands on the wheel where they were in, you know. Maybe the brother in South Carolina was shot in the back. Maybe his problem was he didn't have his hands on the wheel. So at the end of the day, none of this stuff, you know, these prescriptions on how you deal with it and everything makes a lot of sense, except within the context of that framing that, hey, Black Lives Matter, and it's broad enough where you can go almost anywhere with it. That was what was missing. That was what allowed Charles Barkley and Michael to say what they said.
Thanks, Dr. Edwards. I appreciate you coming to and speaking to us and all the stuff that you've done. My name is Jeff Montes de Oca. I'm at UCCS, University of Colorado, Colorado Springs. I'm also a sociologist who does a lot of historical work. So I really appreciated the ideal types you had, the four different waves, and the way in which you're able to point to people like Muhammad Ali as you know, representative of these different time periods. But and I also had a question following up on yours about that period of the 80s and 90s where things are so quiet. And so you talked about Jordan and Barkley, but I was thinking also about Terrell Owens in that time period, who is not an activist. I wouldn't call him an activist because there's not the sort of clear political project that we can see in Colin Kaepernick. But he received a tremendous amount of backlash from the media for being unapologetically Black, right? For being very, very Black in that space. And then when you talk about the importance of social media, I'm thinking of, what's that guy's name? Chad Ochocinco, right? The athletes that in that time period really were pioneering self-promotion on social media as athletes. And so again, not activists by any stretch of the imagination, but are still engaging in a politics of the self. And I was wondering just, you know, what are your thoughts on this?
I put Jack Johnson in the first wave because he was engaged in the international arena and legitimized Black athletic prowess and capability at a time when a fundamental core of racial segregation, athletes and everybody else Black, was that we lacked the intellect, the physical ability, and so forth to be great athletes. The 1904 Racial Olympics in St. Louis, they actually took Black people off the street in St. Louis and ran them against white athletes, trained athletes, to show that we were physically incapable of competing and so forth. Jack Johnson in the international arena fought and proved that not to be the case, not by his own, I'm going out here and stand up and do this, but by the fact of his accomplishments, he made that contribution. Jack Johnson was really about Jack Johnson. Made it very, very clear. He didn't care what Black folks thought or white folks, anybody else. He was about Jack Johnson. He was in the business of being Jack Johnson. When I look at Ochocinco, when I look at T.O., who we drafted at the 49ers, I look at guys who were not representative of any political philosophy. They were about being themselves. which in the end, at one level or another, ends up alienating everybody, because you're not for anybody. You're in the business of being yourself. T.O. was about being T.O. You know, and Ocho Cinco was about Ocho Cinco. He wasn't representing black people or trying to make a stand on anything. There was no ideological framework out there such as Black Lives Matter to frame up what they were doing. Now, in a different era, would T.O. Have been among those athletes who stood up and made a stand on something more substantive? Probably, because he had that disposition, and if that gave him a path of self-expression within the context of that ideological framework, he probably would have taken it. But under circumstances where he came through in an era when there really was no such framework, these are guys who basically were representative of themselves. They were determined to be themselves, whether anybody liked it or not, black, white, or otherwise. And most people didn't like it. Not that they cared. T.O. didn't give a snap one way or the other. He was going to be himself. So, and the same with Ocho Cinco. So I don't put those guys in the same category as these athletes that came afterwards or the ones who came before. And the struggles that they waged were basically for individual expression to such an extent that it became not just a distraction, but in some instances disrupted entire organizations top to bottom. That's a different level of individual expression. I wouldn't call it activism. Activism has some broader connectedness, some broader rationale, explanation for comprehension. These are iconoclastic individuals. Doesn't necessarily make them bad, but it most certainly does not make them relevant. Okay. That about it? Has everybody suffered enough?
We're out of time for questions, unless you're willing.
Yeah, of course I will.
Okay.
I mean, I'm
I want to follow up on part of your program when you talked about HBCUs as a vehicle and you saw the dissemination lead. Also, there was part before Missouri made the move they did. You also had the Grambling football team with the boycott that many people don't necessarily, that was shortly before
that. Talk about that.
And
yeah.
You also have this space where HBCUs are looking to the Black National Anthem, Negro Spiritual, and that space. So I'm always intrigued in terms of when we look at the wider perspective of Black, but specifically start to look at HBCUs in that space.
Yeah.
Where do they show in this share in this conversation, well, and do they provide a platform?
Yeah, they're germane to the conversation because you're talking about residuals of first wave challenges. The idea of singing the Negro National Anthem in the place of the National Anthem would not go over very big at USC. I mean, it is not, you know. So this is one that is institutionally confined, constrained. The Grambling football team that boycotted actually cost them a game. Over the firing of a coach and the reprimand of Doug Williams over some efforts that he made to upgrade facilities at Grambling occurred before the University of Missouri. Got no press because the basic mainstream press treats African American institutions, historically black institutions, the same way they treated black athletes back with during first wave era. They ignore them. And so the fact that, with the exception of me probably and a handful of other people who really pay attention to this kind of thing, we're not even aware of what was going on with regard to Grambling University. Today, historically black institutions are in a situation where they cannot recruit blue chip black athletes. And every now and then you see these games that they will play largely for financial reasons in order to be able to sustain athletic departments, where some historically black institution is playing an ACC school, or playing Clemson, or playing K Cal are playing some, and the score is 79-10. And the referees are going into the locker rooms at halftime asking the coaches, is it okay if we keep the clocks running and you don't call timeouts just so we can get through this? But it's a payday for those institutions that are playing schools that have $14 million football budgets and they have a $4 million athletic department budget, you know. And so they not only cannot recruit the blue chip black athlete, because those athletes want a Heisman Trophy stand, they want to go to SC, they want to be on television every week, they want to be ranked, they want to be talked about, they want to be discussed on the pregame shows with Desmond Howard and Herb, what's name Street or whatever his name is. They want all of that. But they are in a position where they're in these human sacrifice games, where these kids go out. They're outmanned, outgunned, but they bring money into the schools. To try to get a handle on where do we go in terms of athletics and these institutions, even when it comes to basketball. Greatest basketball in the world used to be played by historically black institutions. Now, hey, they're going to North Carolina. Why? Because that's where Michael went. You know, they're going to Texas, they're going to Oklahoma, they're going to Missouri, they're going to all these other schools. Every now and then you'll have a player on a team. I mean, go back and look at how many athletes from historically black institutions were drafted into the NBA over the last 3 years. You could get them all in these first four seats out here in front. So these schools are struggling for not just their existence, but for their legitimacy. They're still fighting that struggle that first wave athletes fought when most of these schools emerged. They have not escaped that. That struggle continues. The issue is, will they survive it? And that's becoming increasingly questionable in the area of athletics, because there are some people right now who are pushing for a total ban on these human sacrifice games, where a lot of these schools make enough money to continue their athletic program throughout the year. And if that happens, then a lot of those athletic programs are finished. They will not be able to survive, especially in revenue producing sports of football and basketball, where there's some travel and so forth involved. So that's another whole area of lecture and discussion, but they're most certainly part of the discussion.
Dr. Edwards, thank you so very much for your presentation. So we know from the literature, and I can attest from my experience as an undergraduate at Penn State University, that these large college institutions are able to wait out black student activists or student activism in general. We come in waves and they tend to wait us out. We also know that black athletes who get involved in activism face different types of resistance from fans. They face institutional resistance. They face resistance from administrators, from sports staff, et cetera. And then we know that that also extends into the professional realm as well. So my question is, how useful is a formal organization for African-American athletes who want to engage in activism? And, you know, do you see the possibilities of such an organization come into existence? And can you talk a little bit about what that might look like? I'm thinking of a formal infrastructure, an entity that would support and undergird the efforts of both undergraduate and professional black athletes to have a voice without fears of being marginalized, separated, castigated, et cetera. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
One of the things that I've learned over the years is that the cycle of recruitment and graduation or leaving a school puts a limit on the impact that any particular cohort of activist athletes are going to have, because the same people that they're fighting against in many instances are the people who appoint successors and who, in point of fact, decide who they're going to recruit as athletes coming in, oftentimes with the proviso, we want to get the right kind of kid in here. And so I'm very much aware of that. This doesn't mean that athletes will not continue to become activists, because what generates that activism is the framing of the issues and the circumstances, the objective circumstances that they're confronting within the institutional context, whether it be an athletic department on a campus or simply in the broader society where they feel an obligation to step up and speak up. So you have these circumstances where one generation after another of athletes, one wave of athletes after another, become activists only to be replaced, displaced by a subsequent wave of athletes because the circumstances that they're challenging remain unresolved, substantially unresolved. And under circumstances where there are no final victories, just as the historically black schools are still fighting for legitimacy, just as in these traditionally white institutions, you still find athletes fighting for access, for dignity and respect, for coaches, for others. I mean, how many black commissioners do you have of these major collegiate conferences which are utterly dependent on black athletic talent, the Southeastern Conference. I mean, you watch LSU playing Alabama, it looks like Ghana playing Nigeria in football. In basketball, it's even worse. And so at the end of the day, what you find is one wave of activists after another being displaced. They fade from the scene like the morning mist before the rising sun, but inevitably, the night comes again, and you find the mist rising again. You find another wave of athletes at the forefront. In terms of how do you institutionalize an ongoing, more or less permanent structure to deal with those challenges, it has to be external to any particular program. For example, you can't have something at Penn State that ultimately is going to influence and impact something at USC or at Cal or at UCLA. You have to have what is in effect the same model that the coal miners union has put together, that the AFL-CIO has put together. They're not attached to any one particular business. They're over everybody who works in that arena. And so I think external organization is the next logical step. And believe it or not, this is already underway in terms of people trying to establish player unions, in terms of people trying to establish not necessarily unions, but most certainly negotiation bodies on behalf of collegiate athletes. All of that is underway. And the money has become so big now, you know, where you have literally tens of millions of dollars paid out to schools and conferences as a result of the Final Four and as a result of a national football, as a national championship game in football and the playoffs, that it's become obscene to have the circumstances that not just black athletes, but all athletes are faced with. And once you organize around the circumstances of the 99 percenters, the true 99 percenters, where 1% is creaming off virtually everything, and the 99% who produce it, in many instances, get nothing. Once they are organized, then within that context is where you begin to work with that structure to bore down into what impacts African-American athletes, men and women, who, by the way, are in even greater peril than black men under the circumstances that we're confronting today, the way that things are evolving. So you want to look at an external structure that looks at the totality of the exploitive situation, that looks at the totality of this 99 percenter, as the Occupy movement would call them, situation. And then once that is underway and established within that context, you then begin to develop, as we always have, what is in effect a black caucus. We have a black caucus in Congress, we have black judges associations, we have black sociologists, we have, you know, the whole nine yards. Why? Because it is necessary in order to bore down into the particular issues and concerns that they have. But in terms of any individual school, nothing is going to change in that regard other than this continual rollover until it becomes dire enough again, and then you have another explosion of athlete activists, such as at Missouri or at Oklahoma or any number of other schools over the last few years.
Okay. Good afternoon, Gary Sales, Indiana University. How are you doing?
Oh, I'm doing well. Thank you.
Okay, real quick question. I want to revisit the point that you made earlier about these smaller schools playing against larger schools. Mm-hmm. We had a local news story about that in Indiana, and IU played Hope College just a few days ago, you know, preseason, you know, getting the guys ready. We beat them by 40. But so the news story was talking about how this payday was for these smaller athletic departments and how they really need that money to survive. So we had a class discussion. My graduate classes, how does this affect the athletes that have to play that game? We thought that it would be adverse and be critical and would be negative. Actually, we were surprised by our results. So I wanted to get your take on these results. They were actually happy to be on that stage. They were happy to be in that arena, to be playing against a famous coach. You know what I'm saying? The celebrity piece. Is that naive? I mean, this is what they told us in our thing. Yeah, I just wanted to get your response to that.
Well, if you're talking about basketball, it can be spun almost any kind of way. I've had coaches say, hey, we're gonna play against some pros today. They're coming in and it's gonna be tough, but we're gonna learn a lot, you know, against basketball. But when you're talking about football, that's a whole different story. When you have Clemson lining up against, you know, South Carolina A&T, whatever, that's human sacrifice. Football at the elite collegiate level and the NFL level, about as close as you can get to war and still stay civil. You could literally get killed out there. You could incur injuries that you will carry for the rest of your life. It's not accidental that the military and the NFL and the NC2A are collaborating on padding and helmets, because at one level or another, they're both concerned about the same kinds of issues. So if you're talking about basketball, you can spin that any kind of way. So a guy goes out and somebody puts up 50 on him. It happens at the pro level. They get over it. Why? Because they're going to play another game before the end of the week. And they'll get somebody out there, and maybe they'll get a chance to put up 50. They maybe even learned a few moves from somebody that they played against who happened to be better. That's one thing. Basketball is a game. Football, it's something else. Yeah, I used to ask my classes at Berkeley, how many of you like football? Every hand in place go up. How many of you like professional football? Oh, my team is on there. Every hand go up. And I asked them, how many of you have ever stood on the sideline during a Super Bowl game or a championship playoff game? Not a hand go up. And I have to tell them, you don't know if you like football or not. Because if you've ever stood on the sideline, and I stood on the sideline for 20 years, 49ers, and some of the things that I saw is simply unbelievable. You don't see those kinds of things other than in the most tragic kinds of automobile and vehicle accidents and war. And every now and then, because of the technology, something will happen and they'll run it back and forth on instant replay, and you see people turn their head on. Oh, don't run that again. That's different than basketball. So if they're talking about basketball, yeah, I can understand how a coach could spin that, although I still think it's unjustifiable, other than for the money. But football, under no circumstances. Under absolutely no circumstances. It's too brutal. It's too brutal a sport.
Please join me in thanking Harry Edwards for his time today.
Thank you.